Hi, welcome to the Noise Path. In this episode, we're going to talk about this SourceTronic ST2516, which is a DC resistance meter. Now, I actually recorded half of this video already, and because I'm a genius, I have lost that footage because I formatted the wrong SD card. So we're going to have to record the beginning once again. And I'll tell you everything that I did step by step so you get to see what I went through. Now, the reason I was initially starting this was because when you power this instrument on, it has a little buzzer inside and it makes a beeping noise, and it was extraordinarily loud. I used an audio measurement device to measure it, and it was coming at an eardrum piercing 110 dB. So I think the reason for that is because that alarm is probably for a very loud environment, so that if this thing violates or whatever limits you put in, it will basically alert the user, the end user, that it is making that noise. But nonetheless, that had to be changed in order for it to be used in the lab. Now, even though you could disable it once the unit runs, as soon as you power it down, it let out a long beep that you couldn't get rid of. At least I couldn't figure out how to. Now, this is by a company called SourceTronic. Never heard of it before, actually. And their motto seems to be, we love electrons, which I guess is a minimum requirement if you're going to make test and measurement instrument. Now, the DC resistance meter like this uses Ohm's law, essentially. It's very different than some of the other units that I have that measure also very small resistances. And this thing can put out up to an amp. And because of that, it has a resolution of 1 micro-ohm. So you can measure really tiny resistances, very useful around the lab. So let's go ahead and take it apart. I'll show you what I did inside and why it was so loud and the changes I made to it. And we can also see the teardown, and then we'll do the experiments. And here is what is inside of this instrument. Now, if you look closely, there are 2 standoffs over here. And on top of these standoffs used to sit this monstrosity. This huge piezoelectric buzzer was the reason why this thing was so loud. Now, after I removed it, there used to be a connector over here where this thing was essentially plugged into. And I looked around this area for the circuitry, and there was a jumper wire that was jumping across 2 pins over here. And those pins were labeled 3.3 volts and 12 volts. And it was basically bridging the 12 volt. I removed that jumper and I put my own little pin header there with a little jumper like this that I can just manually move around if I want to. And I figured what was going on is that there were 2 options for the buzzer. 1 small one, this is the one that I installed in the unit, and for a very large one. The small one runs from 3.3 volts and the large one runs from 12 volts. So you can imagine how loud it must have been. And this is clearly something that was designed to accommodate either of those buzzers, and by just simply moving that bridge, you could configure it. So basically, I just removed the big one and put the small one in there, and it is now much more quiet. We'll measure the sound coming from it in just a moment. Now, for the rest of the instrument, we do have an XP processor here in the front panel. This is very common where the GUI processor and basically the operating system of the instrument runs in the front panel, and then there's a connection from there into the main board. This is pretty much how all of these bench meters and bench instruments are now built. Now, looking from this side, we have a very nice transformer going into the entire power supply section of the instrument. There's a filter over here. And then from the NXP processor and the front panel, all the digital controls come into these two ribbon cables. I've moved them up here temporarily, and they connect to a Max2 FPGA. And then from this is a glue logic controlling everything else you see on this instrument. If you also look closely, you see that there's a bank of transistors over here and some opto-isolators there, and there's a progressively smaller and smaller resistor going down this path, and ultimately we reach a much, much smaller resistance, very large body there to connect it as a heatsink to the main chassis, double wired probably for sense. And it's very obvious that these are the different current ranges, and at this maximum current of 1 amp, you're probably activating through there and you're sensing this and you're figuring out how much current you're putting in. And that's exactly, I think that's how it figures out how much current is being pushed into the device under test. There's a fan over here, strategically right in front of where all the currents are being burned. There are 3 wires over here and a transistor that's just barely out of view connected to the chassis on this side. This is clearly an afterthought because of whatever that must have happened here, they probably couldn't meet the thermal budget of it. So instead they connected it to the side of the chassis, just like they have done with this resistor, moved it away from the center of the instrument. And then everything else is really pretty self-explanatory, nothing unusual going on. We do have a temperature sensor interface in the back, which you can plug in, and that compensates for the temperature measurements, and you can get a reference temperature of what's going on from outside. There's a serial and USB port in the back as well, which has to be routed all the way onto this FPGA and then ultimately into that board. It's a little unusual to see such a big mix of analog and digital directly on the same board with no filtering and shielding or anything, but I'm assuming that they've done their homework and it has to work, otherwise you would never get that 1 micro-ohm resolution for making any reasonable measurements. Other than that, it's really a straightforward device. So let us turn it on and see how loud it is compared to, I cannot show you the old one anymore because I removed it, but at least we know that it used to measure 110 dB. Okay, let's give it a try. I'm going to put this on max hold so that it just keeps the loudest noise it comes across. Let's turn it on. There you go, 87. Still pretty loud. The back of the unit is open, but it is significantly more quiet than what used to be there. Okay, so this was everything that I erased. Now we can get back to the rest of the video where I do the experiments with the unit. And this thing is now up and running, and we got ourselves some Kelvin clips plugged into the instrument, like so. So we should be able to connect this to something. Now the first thing to do is to zero this instrument by connecting everything together. I'll do that off screen to just have a zero adjustment, which will get rid of basically all the internal resistances as well as the thermoelectric effect. We'll talk about that in a second because that's an interesting thing. I'm going to set it up and see how that works. But first, let's measure some known resistances. Okay, let's start with a good old 1-ohm resistor. Let's see what we get. Here we go. And that's pretty good. This is a 1-ohm, 1% tolerance resistor. As you can see, it's 1.0076 is a pretty good result. All right, let's go 10 times smaller. This is now 0.1 ohm. Let's see what we get. Not too bad. And this is also a 1% resistor. 109 milliohm is a reasonable number. Now, one thing to keep in mind is that these resistors do have sense ports as well as the actual ports of the resistor. We should be using them in that four-wire measurement mode, but in reality, our Kelvin clips make connections at the interfaces. So it's not ideal, but it's good enough. And let's go 10 times smaller again. This is now 0.01 ohm. Here we go. 10.6 milliohm. Again, not terrible. Let it settle down. Yeah, reasonable. And we're measuring it in the slowest speed, which just gives us some additional averaging. I haven't done any other averaging on top of it, but I think this is also reasonable. So how about going even smaller? This is a 0.3 milliohm resistor, 300 micro-ohm. And you can see there's a tiny bit of cut in there that's most likely when it's been trimmed. And this is a surface mount component for measuring very high values of current, producing a very small burden voltage essentially, and that you can put on a PCB with big thick traces and build essentially an ammeter out of it. Let's go and measure this and see what this tells us. And here we are. I think that's a pretty reasonable value. 0.303 milliohm is what it's measuring. Now there's something here called OVC, which is offset voltage correction. What happens if we turn that off? Let's go over here, measurement setup, and turn this thing off and go back. What are we measuring? Now we're measuring 0.280. Now that's not a lot, but that's a significant amount when you're looking at a 0.3 milliohm resistor. You can go back and enable it again, going back to the original value we had. So what is going on over there? Well, that happens because the metal that this resistor is made of, in this case copper, and whatever the surface finish of this is, they're going to create the thermoelectric effect. And there's going to be a very, very small voltage developed, which is a function of the ambient temperature, as well as the function of these metal resistors, differences between the two metal surfaces. And depending on the orientation and so on, it can either go up or down in resistance. So how does this OVC account for that? How does it correct for that? In order to understand this, we need to add a few things to our setup to really figure out how this thing is fixing that effect. Now, one thing I do want to say is to not mistake the operation of this instrument with something like the HB4338B, which is also a milliohm meter, but this operation is completely different. It uses a totally different principle of this measurement, but you can see it's still giving us the impedance to be about 0.01 ohm resistor of this particular one, but it's also giving us the angle, which means that it's doing some vector measurement. We can talk about the operation of this one later, but I have repaired this instrument in a different video. Okay, so here's our modified setup. Now, all I've done is that I have added an oscilloscope, in this case, the Keysight MSOX6004A, and there is a current probe connected to it, wrapped around the force terminal. So any current going through the force terminal that this instrument generates, which goes through your device under test, can be shown here in real time. And right now, there's nothing connected, so the current is sitting at zero. Now this line over here, at the top here, this is 1 amp, and we know that this instrument is capable of delivering a maximum of 1 amp. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go over here. I'm going to turn off the OVC. Okay, so there's no correction being done there. We're going to measure our resistor here. And we expect this instrument to push the entire 1 amp because this is a pretty small resistor. And we'll let this settle. And this is going to trigger. There it is. Look at that. This is exactly 1 amp. So the instrument is doing exactly what we want it to do. It's pushing 1 amp of continuous current through the device under test and is measuring the voltage across it. And that is going to give you from Ohm's law the measurement. And we can see the value of that resistor over there. But let's see what happens when I turn on the OVC. Okay, without changing anything else, just go over here, turn the OVC on. Let's see what happens now. And look at that. Now we're getting a square wave instead of the continuous 1 amp. So the instrument applies the 1 amp, then it doesn't apply anything, and then 1 amp, and then nothing, and it continues doing that. Why? Well, that's because the force terminals and the sense terminals of this instrument for measuring resistance are separate. And that's a big advantage, because if you turn off the current and only use the sense port, you actually can measure the voltage developed here. And that voltage is going to be developed because of the bimetal interface, is the thermoelectric effect. So basically what it does is that it constantly corrects for that. It does an open circuit measurement, measures the thermoelectric, then it pushes the current, measures it again, subtracts those values, and then it calculates from the Ohm's law what the resistance is. It's a very simple method to do this. It works because it's going to slow down your measurement, because now you're going to take more measurements in order to be able to tell the user what the resistance is, but it will correct that thermoelectric effect. And because it's done continuously and in the background, any change in temperature is also compensated for. There's also a temperature sensor in the back of this. You can even measure the temperature of the ambient on top of that. And there's additional corrections you can do. And there you have it. I hope you enjoyed this quick video. This is a nice addition to the lab because of its ability to drive 1 amp. If you have a short circuit on a PCB, or you're looking for a short in a transformer or something, this can do it very well. And if you have a thermal camera, while this is making its measurement, you can even find the fault, because 1 amp is a lot of current, and therefore you will be able to see the thermal effect on it. Overall, pretty nice unit. Let me know what you think in the comment section. I'll see you next time.